21st Chief of Staff of the United States Air Force, General David L. Goldfein. We are also honored to have as a member of our official party, the Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Ash Carter. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise. In battles of old, the color guard led the charge. These guardsmen braved the enemy fire to inspire their fellow warriors to victory. Escorting the colors of the United States of America is the United States Air Force Honor Guard. This 270-member unit is made up of ceremonial guardsmen from various career fields that have served in military conflicts and humanitarian efforts throughout the world. Marching before you with pride is the Air Force's best. The Air Force Honor Guard. A distinctive feature of military ceremonies is the formal presentation of command to the reviewing official. After the commander of troops presents the command, musical honors will be played in honor of Secretary Carter. please remain standing for the advancement of the colors, the playing of our national anthem, and the invocation. The Air Force Chief of Chaplains, Chaplain Dondi E. Costin, will now deliver the invocation.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we close our eyes in prayer, the world looks on with eyes wide open, baffled that the civilian control of the military we take for granted still works in a world where take no prisoners is the order of the day. But on this day, we celebrate the vision of our nation's founders, who graced us with a system of government that the world might see as mysterious, but that we know is miraculous. One glance around the globe is all it takes to remind us that for most of its inhabitants, our peaceful transition of power is a sight for sore eyes. For this breathtaking blessing, Lord, we give you thanks and praise. Yet in that same breath, we're forced to acknowledge that for us, this is a mixed blessing, because one consequence of this election means saying farewell to an Air Force secretary who consistently demonstrated that honorable was not just a fancy title, but a way of life. Thank you for honoring Deborah Lee James with your presence as she honored us with hers. Like her biblical namesake, our Deborah has been quick to listen, savvy to speak, and ready to act for the good of her country. America's airmen are better off because her actions spoke louder than her words. When skeptics said no, she said go. As an air power advocate, battle-tested bureaucrat, cost-cutting technocrat, globe-trotting diplomat, her high-flying, death-defying, gun-slinging, selfie-taking, flash-mobbing, heartwarming, hands-on leadership showed us that patriotism was never meant to be passive. And with Mr. Beatty on her wing, Lord, this power couple's passion proved that taking care of people is taking care of business. Because while careers can be consuming, families are forever. And finally, Father, we ask you to plant the 23rd Psalm in the heart of our 23rd secretary. Be her shepherd as she steps off this rat race track after more than 3 years as our shepherd. Restore her soul near the quiet waters of some beach, somewhere, sometime, real soon. For there is no more peaceful transition of power than the comfort only your rod and staff can provide. As number 23 and her number 1 exit the public eye today, may they never lose sight of that. Amen.
Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, Secretary Carter.
Good morning, everyone. Well, 1981, and a recent master's graduate traveled to Washington to apply for the dream job she'd been working towards for years, a position with the U.S. Foreign Service. But this aspiring diplomat's so-called Plan A didn't work out. The Department of State had no positions. But thankfully, this bright young graduate remained committed to serving her country, and the Defense Department was hiring. So she decided to go with her Plan B, a position with the Department of the Army. That job launched a career in national security that led her to Capitol Hill, the defense industry, and back to the Pentagon. So General Goldfein, members of Congress, Frank, DOD colleagues past and present, the State Department's loss was our gain. Because today, we're here to celebrate Debbie James's leadership as our 23rd Secretary of the Air Force, the pinnacle of a remarkable three-decade-long career safeguarding our nation's defense. I want to especially welcome Debbie's family, husband Frank, children Sam, Regina, and Michelle. Thanks for the support you've provided her throughout her career. I know how much love and support you've given her, and I know you must be proud, as we are, of everything she's accomplished. As Secretary, Debbie ensured that the Air Force continued to soar to new heights in defense of our great nation, sustaining the excellence we've come to expect over more than seven decades. She led the organizing, training, and equipping of the more than 600,000 men and women in the United States Air Force, active duty, Air National Guard, and Reserve, always putting them, our people, first. And those airmen are out here right now, confronting no fewer than five immediate evolving challenges around the world. They've conducted over two-thirds of our coalition's airstrikes against ISIL, enabling our partners to take back critical territory in Iraq and Syria, show that there cannot be an Islamic State based upon this ideology, dealing ISIL the lasting defeat it deserves and will receive. They're basing advanced assets and maintaining continuous bomber presence in the Asia Pacific, the single region of the world most consequential to our nation's future, to safeguard allies and partners, and to deter continued North Korean aggression. In the face of Iran's malign influence in the Gulf, they're working closely with our partners to strengthen integrated air and missile defense capabilities across the region, prevent the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, and maintain a strong and credible deterrent capability in the region. And they're playing a vital role in deterring Russian aggression in Europe, supporting our NATO allies, deploying F-22s, and spearheading a persistent and dominant air presence in the region. In addition to these five challenges, our airmen have also continued to flawlessly execute the Air Force's core missions around the world. They maintain U.S. air and space superiority, ensuring that our military can operate and project power everywhere in the world. They conduct countless ISR missions all over the world while maintaining the ability to rapidly mobilize to anywhere they're called. And they operate the capabilities that provide both global strike and command and control, critical elements of our nuclear deterrent. And of course, even as we meet these current challenges, Secretary James knows and has helped us all and everyone in the Air Force to remember that we must find what she's called, quote, the right balance between preserving the Air Force of today and building toward the Air Force of tomorrow. Despite increasing op tempo, Debbie always focused on readiness and growing the force to make sure our airmen can not only meet today's challenges, but also address those we may confront in the uncertain future. To stay ahead and to maintain U.S. air superiority in the face of 21st century threats. She helped the Air Force advance key capabilities like the F-35 stealth fighter, the B-21 long-range strike bomber, and the KC-46 tanker, as well as innovative programs like the Arsenal plane and swarming 3D printed microdrones. Recognizing that nuclear deterrence is the bedrock of our security, Debbie also demonstrated a strong commitment to sustaining that deterrent by reversing decades of underinvestment in the nuclear enterprise. Not only to address troubling issues that had arisen over the years, but also to recapitalize both of the Air Force's two legs of our nuclear triad, land-based intercontinental ballistic missiles and bombers. Debbie's leadership in this regard is truly a hallmark of her tenure, and it's critically important. In fact, she visited our Air Force's nuclear bases on her first trip as secretary, and she returned to Minot and Malmstrom on her final trip just last week. There, she ran focus groups with nuclear force airmen, something she's been doing since the beginning of her tenure, to learn how our policies are affecting them. And with these conversations, Secretary James has established an important feedback loop between airmen and senior leadership, and she'll pass along the lessons learned from these conversations to her successor. In addition to all this, Secretary James also helped sustain our deterrence and much more by investing in space, a domain that's woven into every aspect of our military operations today, conventional and nuclear alike. To prepare for the future, Debbie has also been a key leader in making certain DoD is ready to deter and defend against attacks in space by making serious investments in the capabilities that enhance our ability to identify, to attribute, and to negate threatening actions by others in space. And as the principal DoD space advisor and the person upon whom I and the president have relied, Debbie has helped integrate space into our core contingency plans and made sure our space capabilities are as resilient and assured as our nuclear capabilities, all the more important given that we now view space as a potential warfighting domain. Now, of course, over the years, Secretary James has also focused on the strength of the force. Debbie never lost sight of what that greatest strength is, which is our people. She always put the men and women of the Air Force first, saying, we're going to take care of you and your families so that you, in turn, can take care of us. And throughout her tenure, it's clear that Debbie always takes care of America's airmen first. We see that in her advocacy for more resources to help our men and women carry out their missions. We see it in the Get Well plan she established for the Air Force's fleet of remotely piloted aircraft, and her dedication to supporting our nuclear force personnel, ensuring that they have the opportunity to advance and succeed in their careers. And we also see it in her important commitment to ridding the ranks of sexual assault, in particular by focusing on presenting these terrible offenses against honor and trust, which are the foundations of the profession of arms, from happening in the first place. But Secretary James's commitment to airmen extends beyond taking care of the force we have today. She's also been a wonderful partner in laying the groundwork for the Air Force and the Joint Force of the future, helping ensure that our military remains the finest fighting force the world has ever known. Debbie has worked tirelessly to foster a long-term commitment to diversity and inclusion in the Air Force, rightly noting that, quote, diversity of background, experience, and skill are paramount when it comes to innovation and the capability to perform. She's taken a hands-on approach through mentorship and running a lean-in circle. Through her leadership, she's fostered a commitment to developing the talents of the next generation of airmen, making sure that our Air Force will not only have the capabilities it needs, but also the leaders it needs to execute its core missions with excellence long into the future. As we honor all of Secretary James's contributions to this department and our country this morning, I know I speak on behalf of everyone here, not only the entire Air Force, but also in the entire Department of Defense, when I say to you, Debbie, that your Plan B worked out awfully well for the country and the department. And Deb, I gotta say on a personal note, our friendship, my admiration for you go back many years. I've been especially fortunate, though, in the last few years as Secretary of Defense to have you as my trusted and unfailingly effective partner in strengthening and applying the Air Force. Thanks, pal. Because of your leadership, the United States Air Force is better prepared to fly, fight, and win than at any time in history. Across the many missions we ask our Air Force to complete, across the many domains we ask them to dominate, the foundations of this proud service are stronger than ever. Thank you, Debbie James, for your service to this country, for your commitment to our airmen, to their families, and to the Joint Force. We're safer today because of you.
Please rise as Secretary Carter presents the Department of Defense Medal for Distinguished Public Service to Secretary James. The Honorable Deborah Lee James is recognized for distinguished public service as the 23rd Secretary of the Air Force from 20 December 2013 to 20 January 2017. Ms. James exhibited outstanding leadership in organizing, training, and equipping our United States Air Force and provided critical advice to the President of the United States during a period of increased military operational tempo. Focusing on taking care of people, Ms. James championed greater end strength for the United States Air Force by making total force integration a top priority. During her tenure, Ms. James revitalized the Nuclear Enterprise Core mission, executed the remotely piloted aircraft get well plan, easing the strain on the force, and was a strong advocate for the prevention of sexual assault, violence, and suicide across the enterprise. Ms. James promoted diversity and inclusion, launching 22 initiatives to expand opportunities to serve in the United States Air Force, which included opening all career fields to women in the Air Force. Understanding the importance of balancing readiness for a high-end fight today with a modernization for tomorrow, Ms. James was critical to the increase of funding for Air Force readiness accounts and advanced the top three modernization programs, the F-35 Joint Strike Fighter, KC-46A Pegasus Tanker, and B-21 Raider Bomber, ensuring that our United States Air Force is ready to meet the nation's national security challenges. In addition, Ms. James increased investments in globally integrated intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. She enabled the critical investments for the United States Air Force space missions, safeguarding United States Air Force leadership in the space domain. Ms. James also served as the principal Department of Defense space advisor, where she launched the Space Enterprise Vision, improved space situational awareness capabilities, and stood up the Space Mission Force. During her watch, the United States Air Force continued to lead in the cyber realm, providing key defensive and offensive capabilities to the joint community and the nation. Finally, under her direction, the United States Air Force made every dollar count by reducing headquarters spending, achieved important savings in energy, and utilized the bending the cost curve model to get new technologies and capabilities into the hands of our warfighters more quickly and cost-effectively. The distinctive accomplishments of Ms. James reflect great credit upon herself, the United States Air Force, and the Department of Defense. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, General Goldfein.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, or as they say in General Raymond's hometown of Clemson, howdy. Welcome to this ceremony to honor our Secretary of the Air Force, the Honorable Deborah Lee James, and her husband, Mr. Frank Beatty. As the host for today's events, it is my distinct honor to also serve as the welcomer in chief. And I'll begin with two members of not only the greatest generation, but also our original Tuskegee Airmen, Colonel Charles McGee and Mr. Major Anderson. Gentlemen, would you please stand and be recognized? The long blue line continues. Our Deputy Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Bob Warrick, sir, thank you for your steadfast leadership and your passion for excellence. I think you may have the best quote ever when describing our Air Force. During your AFA speech, you offered that you had never before spoken to an audience with only a binary choice in life: live in fame or die in flames. It's truly an honor to have you with us today, along with the Honorable Mike McCord, the Honorable Frank Kendall, the Honorable Alan Estevez, and the Honorable Jamie Morin, who have led us so well over the past 8 years. Thank you all for being here and for your dedication. A special welcome to members of Congress who have joined us to honor Secretary James. Representative Garamendi from California, Representative Bordalo from Guam, Representative Scott from Georgia, and Representative Donald Norcross from New Jersey. Thank you so much for your unwavering and continued support for our airmen and their families. We're blessed today to have two of our former secretaries of the Air Force in attendance. The Honorable F. Witten Peters, our 19th Secretary of the Air Force, and the Honorable Michael Donnelly, our 22nd Secretary of the Air Force. Welcome home, gentlemen. Welcome home. Along with our current four-star leadership, we have several retired general officers who, along with our Tuskegee Airmen, represent that long blue line. And those of us privileged to serve today stand on their shoulders. So a special welcome to General Larry Spencer, General John Shod, General Tom Mormon, and General Ron Keyes. Thank you, gentlemen, to you and your spouses, and again, welcome home. And perhaps most important, a warm and special welcome to Secretary James' family. Her husband, Mr. Frank Beatty, her son, Mr. Sam Phillips Lee, her daughter, Ms. Regina Lee Fechter, Frank's daughter, Ms. Michelle Beatty, and their extended family and friends. Thank you for being here to cheer on your wife, your mother, your sister, and your friend, just as you have throughout her tour as our secretary. And finally, to all military leaders, national, state, cities, officials, civic leaders, and to our incredible airmen, thank you for being here to honor this special day in our 70th birthday year. Secretary Carter did a marvelous job highlighting the many accomplishments of Secretary James during her 3 years and 23 days she served as our secretary, and her more than 30 years serving in government. He highlighted her priorities of taking care of airmen and their families, balancing today's readiness with tomorrow's modernization and making every dollar count, which she has championed every day of her tenure, pushing us to think in new ways, challenging our assumptions, and most importantly, always, always, always delivering on our promises with execution and follow-up. Who would have thought that that young woman who dreamed of being a Foreign Service officer would become our Air Force ambassador, traveling to 102 locations in 47 different countries, representing and visiting airmen and their families where they live, where they work, and where they fight? During the reading of the citation to accompany the award of the Defense Medal for Distinguished Public Service, you heard about the many successes we achieved under her steady hand. From reinvigorating the nuclear enterprise to stewarding major acquisition programs to attacking additional duties and excessive computer-based training, our airmen have no better friend than our secretary. And so I will not attempt to repeat those accomplishments other than to say we are a better Air Force because of the passion, the commitment, and the leadership of Secretary Deborah James. So perhaps the most meaningful and heartfelt way for me to help all of us understand the impact Secretary James has had across the Air Force is to hear it directly from the men and women, your airmen, who rode in to share their reflections on what your leadership has meant to them. Lieutenant Colonel Rusty Williford, commander of the 320th Missile Squadron, wrote, "Secretary James has done an amazing job of investing in the nuclear enterprise. The Force Improvement Program was a singular effort to address our culture and climate, but it was also the start of a new philosophy of continuous improvement. She made a difference. When you did a tandem parachute jump at the Air Force Academy, your jump master, Master Sergeant Terrence Murphy, wrote in, saying one of the greatest compliments an Air Force leader can pay their airmen is trust. And Secretary James trusted the Air Force parachute team with her life as she dove for her first time out of a perfectly good airplane. It was a memorable event for the cadets and staff of the Wings of Blue, and we were honored to jump with her. From Yokota Air Base, Japan, one of our key spouses, Jody Warminski, wrote, "I was excited when her 2014 tour brought her to Yokota Air Base, where my family and I are stationed. Her genuine interest in the needs and happenings at Yokota did not go unnoticed. As a female, a spouse, and a mom, it is so great and important to see powerful women fulfilling these roles And I would be lying if I didn't say I also appreciate her great sense of style. The next one comes from Captain Troy Barnes, an RPA pilot at Creech Air Force Base, who said, "The deliberate leadership of Secretary James has been instrumental in a number of areas and promises to normalize the RPA community in the near future. Operational stress levels for individuals at the squadron has truly improved and will continue to improve. Her leadership makes apparent the value she places on our airmen's perspective and ensures this mission will continue as an enduring capability for our nation and our nation's security. And never shy about doing battle with Congress when required, Secretary James fought tirelessly for airmen benefits." Captain Austin Barnes reported, "Secretary James' work with dual military allowance for housing made a huge difference for our family, and we will forever be grateful." And when it came to diversity and inclusion, Secretary James walked the walk. This in from Colonel McGee Sleeper, who participated in the lean-in group she championed. "I was honored the Secretary dedicated time every month not only to lead our group, but to be an active part in it, to open up and share her stories and personal experiences as well. She was learning from us as much as we were learning from her. And the best part is you just knew she truly wanted to know about the airmen and how different things affect airmen, because her bottom line was to make our Air Force better. And when she was inducted as an honorary Tuskegee Airman and received her red jacket, our former Vice Chief of Staff, General Larry Spencer, said, 'I was happy, but I was not at all surprised. She embodies the traits, strengths, courage, and compassion of the Tuskegee Airmen.'" And this last one, this one means a lot to me and to General Rand. It comes from Mrs. Ginger Gilbert Ravella, a Gold Star wife who lost her husband, Troy, in Iraq in 2006 and waited 10 years to repatriate Troy's remains. Ginger wrote, "I am sure I will never know all that Secretary James did for me and for my children regarding finding Troy's remains and the recovery mission. What I do know is she showed up for our family. She showed up in Dover to help us welcome him back to U.S. soil. At his final burial, she warmly hugged our family as we waited to enter the church. I get tears in my eyes as I remember that seeing her felt like seeing a fellow Air Force friend. Troy believed in doing the right thing no matter what. And I know he would have been honored to serve under such a fine leader and person that she is. As Secretary James is reflecting back on her years of service to this nation, I want her to know I most definitely believe Troy was supposed to come home under her diligent and loving watch. God's blessings to her from a proud Air Force fighter pilot's wife. Ma'am, Frank, please take a look around this hangar. At two of our Air Force's instruments of war, and they span the era from Vietnam to today's newest fifth generation fighter. At the flag you have served so proudly and for so long, and at the many airmen you so nobly and ably led. America has asked you to do difficult things, and you delivered. You inspired us, you took care of us, and you led us well. Taking care of airmen and their families, balancing today's readiness with tomorrow's modernization, and making every dollar count. It is now my distinct honor as the 21st Chief of Staff, on behalf of a grateful nation and your 660,000 active Guard, Reserve, and civilian airmen, to report that you have completed your obligation to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that you bore true faith and allegiance to the same, and that you well and faithfully discharged your duties of the office of Secretary of the Air Force. May God bless our great nation and our brave men and women like Secretary James, who choose to defend her. Thank you.
Please rise as General Goldfein presents the Chief of Staff of the Air Force Award for Exceptional Public Service to Mr. Frank Beatty. Mr. Frank J. Beatty distinguished himself by exceptional service to the United States Air Force as the spouse of the Secretary of the Air Force, the Honorable Deborah Lee James, from 20 December 2013 to 20 January 2017. A staunch ambassador for Air Force families, Mr. Beatty visited with service members and their families across the enterprise, devoted his time to advocate and raise awareness on many service-related issues, and tirelessly championed family support programs that improve the quality of life for thousands of members of the Air Force family. Alongside the Secretary, Mr. Beatty engaged with foreign air chiefs and spouses, as well as air attachés and their spouses, representing the Air Force and America in the Washington, D.C. diplomatic community. Mr. Beatty also took part in multiple leadership panels and Air Force town hall meetings to highlight the concerns of military spouses to Air Force flag officers and senior civilians, providing helpful insight for all active duty, Guard, Reserve, and civilian spouse and family issues. He consistently championed the Air Force Families Forever program, designed to provide continued aid to the families of our fallen airmen, and took every opportunity to emphasize the critical role USAID programs play in assisting the citizens of our allied countries when speaking with foreign military, civilian leaders, and their spouses. Mr. Beatty also clearly articulated the challenges airmen face concerning physical and mental health while participating on panels discussing suicide prevention, domestic violence, and post-traumatic stress disorders. He used his unique platform to highlight Air Force heroes by participating in multiple Wounded Warrior events, including two Patriot Cruise and salutes, where wounded warriors and their families were recognized. Throughout his service, Mr. Beatty raised the profile of many critical issues and quality of life concerns within the Air Force community. His selfless dedication in support of the United States Armed Forces and military families highlight his patriotism and reflects great credit upon himself, his family, and the United States Air Force. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the posting of the colors. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, Secretary James.
Thank you and good morning, everyone. And most of all, thank you so much for being here with me today and with my family. Special, special thanks to Secretary of Defense Ash Carter. His kind words really, really touch my heart, and I am so incredibly thankful to him and to the President for the trust that they have placed in me over these last few years. Thank you also to Deputy Work, who I know rearranged his entire schedule to be here, and to the other members of the OSD team on whom we have depend regularly in our Air Force. I know we have members of the Joint Team who are here in the audience today. I see members of our coalition as well. Thank you for turning out. Civic leaders, we have the members of Congress from my very own House Armed Services Committee. Thank you so much, and to the staffs. It really means a lot. And thank you, thank you, thank you to the best chief of staff anybody could have ever hoped for. Thank you, General Goldfein. Chief, as I said, you have just been the best wingman possible to me. And I could not have asked for more, and I cannot wait to see in the years to come what you and Dawn produce and accomplish for our Air Force. It's going to be great things in the future, and I will be watching from afar. And to our Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, Jim Cody. Jim, you have been a fierce advocate for our enlisted airmen, and you have been here for the entirety of my 3 years. I have come to trust you and to listen to you so carefully on so many issues over the past few years. I wish you and Athena the very, very best in your upcoming retirement. And of course, as you know, my family is here today. My husband, Frank, my children, members of my extended family. Thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart so very, very much, because you're always there for me no matter what, supporting me 150%. I love you all very much. And of course, there are dear friends. I was looking out into the audience and I've spotted many of you. I can't wait for the reception so that we can talk at greater length. I have friends in the audience who literally span all the different parts of my life, from my high school years, believe it or not, to my college years, to friends that I met when my children were lifers at the Potomac School in McLean, Virginia, to colleagues from each and every job that I have had, both in government, so folks from the Army, from the House Armed Services Committee days, from my days as the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Reserve Affairs are here, and also from my days in the private sector. I see friends from SAIC, from Leidos in the audience. Again, it means so much to me that you are here today. And a special shout out to Frank's and my newest friends from Prince William Marina, boating forever, yeah. Go Prince William. And of course, there are so many airmen in attendance today. From our terrific team of four-star major command commanders to our Undersecretary Lisa Disbrow, the best Undersecretary I could have hoped for, and our assistant secretaries, our career senior civilians, many members of the AERA staff are here, right on down to even the most junior of airmen who work very, very hard on the details and execution of today's ceremony. So could I ask for a round of applause for our honor guard, the protocol team, and our fantastic second to none Air Force band. Very special to me is my own Team 23. Now these are the folks in my front office, Team Protect, raise the roof, there they are, I see them. This is Team 23 of today, but I've been here 3 years and you know how people rotate. So there are members of Team 23 from a year or two ago who made the effort to be here today. I deeply, deeply appreciate it. It's been such a pleasure to serve with all of you. And Chaplain Costin, last but not least, you once again have outdone yourself, your counsel, your prayers throughout the year. I deeply appreciate that. I'm going to put that autocrat and diplomat and all those things on my resume. I think that'd be a good resume builder. So thank you so much for those inspiring words and for your humor throughout. That's wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, it means a lot to have this opportunity to speak to you one last time as the 23rd Secretary of the Air Force. When I took the job back in December of 2013, I knew that it would be the honor of my professional lifetime. But what I didn't fully understand at the time is what an absolute joy that it would be and how much I would learn from all of you. Now, at times like this, because I've been to a couple of these ceremonies over the last few days, there is a temptation to talk about accomplishments from the past, advice for the future, and certainly I'm grateful that both the Secretary and the Chief touched upon some of that. But that's actually not what I want to do here today. Instead, I want to tell you a series of stories about airmen who I've been privileged to know over my tenure, airmen who have touched my heart in a big way and who will inspire me forever. And it is these airmen, and many, many more, by the way, that I will remember for the rest of my life. And I've narrowed it down to four stories, which, believe me, was really, really hard. So please take these four stories really as illustrative of the fantastic 660,000 men and women, plus their families, who serve in today's Air Force. I made taking care of people my top priority, but airmen have done so much more for me than I could have ever imagined 3 years ago. So let's begin at the beginning. The story for me begins about 2 weeks after I was confirmed as Secretary of the Air Force. I got a call, and it was real bad news. You see, a convoy was hit by an improvised explosive device near Kabul, Afghanistan. 10 people were killed, including an airman, Captain David Lyon. David had been in the Air Force at that point 5 years. He was a logistics specialist, an absolutely fine young officer. He was executive officer to the command group and a tremendous athlete and a volunteer coach from his days on the Air Force Academy track team. It was a heartbreaking situation, the first of several that I would encounter over time. So the week after Christmas of 2013, I went up to Dover Air Force Base in Delaware to attend David's dignified transfer. Now, although many of you in the audience know what a dignified transfer is, perhaps a few do not, so permit me just a moment to explain. When a serviceman or woman is killed or dies overseas, the Air Force is responsible for transporting the body back home. The plane carrying the fallen lands at Dover, where a team carries the casket off the plane with enormous care, enormous precision, and the remains are then taken to the mortuary to be prepared for transport onward to their final resting place. It's not a really a ceremony per se. There is no fanfare. But what it is, it's a very, very solemn moment where a man or a woman who has made the ultimate sacrifice comes home. Members of the family almost always attend, as do official representatives of their service. So in this case, I was there as the Secretary of the Air Force, along with other Air Force senior leaders. And that is where I met Captain Dana Lyon, and also in the Air Force, an acquisitions officer and Dave's widow. She was stationed in Afghanistan when all of this happened, too. She and Dave had spent Christmas together just 2 days before he was killed, and she accompanied his body back home on the aircraft on what must have been the absolute longest flight in the world. Now, this was my first real trip outside of Washington, D.C., and nothing could have quite prepared me for it. Now, prior to the actual dignified transfer, I met Dave's family, his mom, his stepdad, his brother, and I met Dana's family as well, including her brother Eric, another airman. I learned about Dave and Dana's experience at the Air Force Academy and their successes together in college sports. Dana told me about Dave's work with the Wounded Warrior Program and the volunteer activities that they did together. In the midst of unspeakable grief, Dana taught me how much we ask of people in our Air Force. Now, even if I had understood this on an intellectual basis before, she really made it real for me. Our airmen are volunteers, they're warriors, they're professionals at arms, and always our family members are draftees. They provide so much of the support that makes our Air Force possible, and we ask a great deal of them. Dana Lyon, of course, is the double deal. She's an airman and a family member all at the same time. Well, Dana and I have stayed in touch over the last 3 years. We actually started a mentor-mentee relationship under the Air Force's mentoring program called My Vector. Supposedly, get this, I was the mentor and she was the mentee, though I am pretty sure that I got way more out of the relationship than she did. Now, of course, she's no longer Captain Dana Lyon, she's Major Dana Lyon, and she's the Assistant Strength and Conditioning Coach at the Academy. And here's the best part. She is now an active mentor in her own right for scores of young airmen. She has so much to teach them and their families about what it means to be a member of the military, a military spouse, a military supporter. And what she teaches them is it takes resilience. It means being a good wingman for one another, focusing on the mind, the body, the spirit. She teaches them that serving others is the most noble purpose that anyone can pursue. So, ladies and gentlemen, I regret to tell you that I went on to attend 5 more dignified transfers during my tenure, including the final one, which was the one that General Goldfing referenced from long ago, but we finally found that airman and brought him home, Troy Gilbert. I remember them all, but none quite as much as the first one. So Dana is here with us today. Dana, would you please stand and be recognized, because it means the world to me to get to say thank you to you one more time. Dave is very proud of you. The second airman story I want to tell you about is that of Lieutenant General Jack Weinstein, who is now our Deputy Chief of Staff for Strategic Deterrence and Nuclear Integration. But when I met him, he was Major General Weinstein, the commander of the 20th Air Force at F.E. Warren Air Force Base in Wyoming. So now flash forward another week or two. I think I'm 3 or 4 weeks into my tenure at this point. So those first few weeks were pretty eventful. It came to the light that there had been some drug use and cheating on proficiency exams among some of our young missileers at Malmstrom Air Force Base in Montana. Anything that possibly calls into question the safety and security of our nuclear enterprise is a huge deal, and I viewed this as a first big leadership test for me. So what exactly was going on here? Was this just simply a failure of integrity on the part of a few airmen? or was there more to the story? Were there systemic things happening? These were some of the key questions on the table at the time, and I for sure did not have the answers. But one thing I was pretty certain about, though, we in the Air Force leadership needed to get to the bottom of this quickly, and we needed also to make this information public. Because you see, bad news like this doesn't get any better with age, and stuff like this doesn't remain private in a place like Washington, D.C. for very long. So General Welsh and I came forward within 2 days of learning about the incident, and we told the Congress, we told the media, we told the American people what we knew at the time, what we didn't yet know, how we intended to investigate, and that we would be following up. And then I proceeded, as did General Welsh, to fly out immediately to our three ICBM bases. And that's where Jack Weinstein enters the picture. General Weinstein was part of that very first trip with me, and he proved absolutely invaluable in helping me to understand the dynamics of the nuclear enterprise. The zero-defect mentality that was in existence at the time, the rigidity of the training, the micromanaging nature of the culture, how leader after leader in the Air Force would speak about nuclear as being number one, but no one was seeming to follow through and put their money where their mouth was, at least not enough. So armed with this information and after conducting many focus groups with airmen at all levels, I was able to return to Washington, confer with General Welsh and General Wilson, who at the time had been the recently appointed commander of Global Strike, and together we put together a plan of action. And out of that initial bad experience, a lot of good has come. Over time, we have shifted significant dollars. We've shifted significant personnel assets to the nuclear enterprise. We've begun much-needed modernization programs. And most importantly, we have really put the focus on our people with more professional development. There's bonuses and special pays, more empowerment, and a totally revamped training program. And we elevated Global Strike to a 4-star command, which today is so ably filled by General Robin Rand, who is also with us. We're now doing a much, much better job, I believe, of putting our money where our mouth is. And because, as you heard, I do believe in follow-up, I've made it a point to go back again and again just to see how we're doing. I was just, as you heard, in both Malmstrom and in Minot with 50 inches of snow on the ground, by the way, in the month of January. And let me tell you, our airmen are performing magnificently. And with me on this final trip, of course, was none other than Jack Weinstein. And he is still the fiercest advocate for our missileers, our security forces, and all of the other airmen who represent our nuclear enterprise. So, General Weinstein, would you please stand and accept my thanks one more time, really on behalf of all of the men and women who serve our nuclear deterrence. Thank you. Thank you. My third airman of the day is Technical Sergeant Brian Williams, who is one of the most brave, most dedicated people I have ever met. Now, the first time I remember meeting Brian was when he was competing as a member of the Air Force Wounded Warrior Program, which incidentally is a terrific program run out of San Antonio that focuses on those who are ill, wounded, or injured, and their recovery through sports, mentorship, career readiness, and caregiver support programs. Brian first entered the Air Force nearly 16 years ago, and he became a member of security forces. He deployed 6 times in total, 2 times to Afghanistan. On Brian's last deployment in Afghanistan, he was injured in an IED explosion while his unit was trying to clear a Taliban compound. He ended up losing his left leg above the knee. Brian, like many in his situation who are wounded or injured, had a difficult recovery. And eventually, the Air Force was making a move to medically retire him. But you see, Brian wanted to remain in our Air Force. You see, he loved representing the Air Force family that had taken him in 15 years earlier and had done so much for him. But how could the Air Force utilize his skills and experience given his injury? Well, starting back in 2012, the Air Force centralized the Wounded Warrior Program within the Air Force Personnel Center, and we learned some pretty valuable lessons from our airmen who have physical and invisible wounds. And then when I came on board, General Welsh and I directed a review of the ways that the Air Force cares for wounded warriors with an eye towards allowing skilled airmen to more frequently be able to continue to serve and to serve within the Air Force family. So when Brian's time actually came, I was the one who got to sign the paperwork that allowed him to stay in the Air Force. And he is now a Joint Base San Antonio instructor for security forces, for the young airmen who are coming up in that career field. And he's getting a degree in human resources management. But wait, I'm getting a little ahead of the story. So let's go back a moment to last summer in 2016. I was at the Warrior Games in West Point, New York. And Brian was one of the star performers in a number of competitions, but the one I remember so vividly is the seated volleyball competition. Our Air Force team won the gold medal, and none other than yours truly was on hand and called upon to place the medals over the necks of our athletes. So I was going down the line giving the awards, and Brian was about midway down that line, and when I got to him, he refused the medal. I said to myself, oh no, what's going on here? Is this one of those protest moments you sometimes see on television? I was stunned. I said, you must accept this, Brian, you earned it. He said, no ma'am, you have to have it. I said, no way, I can't accept this. He said, sorry ma'am, I'm not accepting it. And then he put it around my neck, and then he explained that he wanted me to have it because I and other Air Force leaders had cared so much and that we had collectively made it possible for him to continue to serve as part of our Air Force family. Well, let me tell you, I have received many, many gifts over the 3 years as Secretary of the Air Force, but nothing quite like this. And it means so much to me to have that gold medal, and I will treasure it for the rest of my life. Brian really showed me just how dedicated our airmen are, how committed they are to service, and how much the opportunity to serve means to them. So it is just such an honor to serve with airmen like you, Brian, and please stand and be recognized. And by the way, no more of this Technical Sergeant Brian Williams talk. Please give a round of applause to Master Sergeant Select Brian Williams. Last airman story, and boy, it's a real inspirational one, just like the first three. The next airman I want to tell you about, it is not at all an overstatement to call this gentleman a giant of American air power. Colonel Charles McGee and his fellow Tuskegee airmen, including Mr. Major Anderson and Colonel Johnson, both of whom are here today, they grew up at a time when separate but equal was the law of this land, and they had to face entrenched racism in our country. And that might have stopped some people, but it didn't stop them. Because you see, when they were on mission, they were exceptional flyers, maintainers, radio operators, and support personnel. They demonstrated without a question that the Air Force core value of excellence in all that we do has absolutely nothing to do with the color of an airman's skin. Colonel McGee, by the way, flew over 400 combat missions, not only in World War II, mind you, but also in Korea and Vietnam. I first met Colonel McGee in June of 2016 at the centenary of another group of remarkable American aviation pioneers, a group called the Lafayette Escadrille. And this was a group of American pilots who volunteered to fight with the French during World War I, even before America became involved with World War I. Since then, I have met up with Colonel McGee and other members of the Tuskegee Airmen on a number of occasions. For example, we met up in Burlington, Vermont later on last summer, where they brought their exhibition called Rise Above, to Vermont. It's a history of the Tuskegee Airmen that inspires young people to never quit and to always aim high. I have never seen a group of young airmen sit and listen with such rapt attention as I saw them sit and listen to the stories of Colonel McGee. Colonel McGee, believe me, during my all calls, there's not that level of rapt attention. And I've also had the Tuskegee Airmen come to my office on several occasions because I wanted to hear more about their experiences. I wanted to share with them some of what we were doing to promote diversity and inclusion in our Air Force. I wanted to pick brains to see what other ideas they could offer to us. Because you see, ours is the world's greatest Air Force precisely because we have the world's greatest airmen, and we are stronger and we are more innovative because we have different races, different ethnicities, genders, geographies represented throughout the force. There's a lot of evidence to support that diverse teams of people produce the most innovative solutions to the thorniest problems. And innovation, after all, is part of the DNA of the United States Air Force. 2017 marks the 70th anniversary of the Air Force as a separate branch of the military, and our motto for this year is American Airmen, Breaking Barriers Since 1947. The color barrier, the sound barrier, barriers between air, space, and cyberspace, between geographies, between the active duty, the National Guard, the Reserve, and our civilian components, nothing can stop the U.S. Air Force. You know, Chief, there's a certain ring to that final phrase. Maybe we should put that into a song. We should think about that for the future. But to Colonel McGee and to the Tuskegee Airmen, you showed us the way on all of this. All of our airmen around the world today who are out there breaking barriers are the heirs to your legacy. As General Goldfein mentioned, Colonel McGee made me an honorary Tuskegee Airman not too long ago, which was just another unbelievable honor that I certainly did not deserve. But believe me, sir, I will wear my red jacket into the future very, very proudly. So I'm so happy, Colonel McGee, and to the other Tuskegee Airmen present, would you please stand one more time so that we can thank you for your decades in uniform, lifetime of service. So now I'm at the end of my last speech as Secretary of the Air Force, and like I said, I very much wanted it to be our airmen and what they have meant to me. Now, I may not be Secretary of the Air Force for much longer, but I will never ever cease being a member of the Air Force family, and I will always remain an advocate for airmen and for the United States Air Force, just as our former secretaries here in the front row have done so ably. I, too, will carry on. And as an American citizen, I will be secure in the knowledge that all of you are out there protecting my family, my friends, and the country that I love 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. You are faithful to a proud heritage and a legacy of valor. You are our nation's sentry and avenger, and you are dedicated to enduring ideals, the ideals of integrity first, service before self, and excellence in all that we do. I cannot express to you how much it has meant to be counted among your ranks for these last 3 years. So finally, let me say one more time, aim high, airmen, aim high. I know you will, and I'll be watching. God bless you. God bless the United States of America.
Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, the United States Air Force Band and Honor Guard will now pass in review in honor of Secretary James. The purpose of this review is to inspect the degree of drill proficiency of airmen and their state of readiness. As a reminder, everyone should stand as the colors pass before them. Military members in uniform should salute, while our civilian guests place their right hands over their heart. Once the colors have passed you, you may be seated. In appreciation for her courageous leadership, the men and women of the United States Air Force express their pride in having served along Secretary James and assure her that she will always be an airman and a member of the Air Force family. At this time, the United States Air Force Band will now play God Bless America in honor of Secretary James's service.
Thank you.
members of the Singing Sergeants from the United States Air Force Band will now perform a rendition of Uptown Girl in honor of Secretary James. Band of the United States Air Force Band, Max Impact, will now conclude the musical tribute with Uptown Funk and American Airmen.
Madam Secretary, we know this is your favorite song. So if you could just order everybody in the audience to clap their hands with me, that would be great. Clap your hands, everybody. Clap your hands, everybody. Come on. Clap your hands, everybody. Clap your hands. Come on. Come on.
This hit that ice cold Michelle Pfeiffer, that white gold. This one for them hood girls, them good girls. Straight masterpiece. Styling, wilding, living it up in the city. Got Chuck's on with Saint Laurent. Gotta kiss myself, so pretty. Come on. Too hot, I dance. Call the police and the firemen. Too hot, I dance. Make the general want to retire, man. Too hot, I dance. Ma'am, say my name, you know who I am. Too hot, I dance. And bad about that money. Come on, girls. Girls, hit you, hallelujah. Girls, hit you, hallelujah. Girls, hit you, hallelujah. Cause Uptown Funk gonna give it to you. Cause Uptown Funk gonna give it to you. Cause Uptown Funk gonna give it to you. Saturday night we're in the spot. Don't believe me, just watch. How y'all doing over here? You good? Don't believe me, just watch. Come on. Hey, hey, hey. Don't believe me, just watch. Don't believe.
put something in it. Take a sip, sign the check. Julio, get the stretch.
Ride to Harlem, Hollywood, Jackson, Mississippi. We're gonna show up, we're gonna show out.
Come on.
Smoother than the first job, Skippy. Too hot,
I'm dead.
Call the police and the fireman. Too hot,
I'm dead.
Make a dragon born to retirement. Too hot,
I'm dead.
Just say my name, you know who I am. Too hot,
I'm dead.
In a pound about that money.
Make it
Secretary, hit your hallelujah.
Ooh.
Secretary, hit your hallelujah.
Ooh.
Ladies, hit your hallelujah.
Ooh.
Cause Uptown Funk gonna give it to you.
Ooh.
Cause Uptown Funk gonna give it to you. Cause Uptown Funk gonna give it to you.
We just saw, huh? Oh, yeah. Now let's sing together. Let's send her off for glory. Come on.
Saturday night, we in the spot.
Don't believe it, just watch. Come on.
Uptown, funk you up. Uptown, funk you up.
Let me hear you.
Uptown, funk you up. Uptown, funk you up.
Come on.
Uptown, funk you up. Uptown, funk you up.
Come on.
Done for us airmen. This one goes out to you.
I'm a century of Avenger. My nation's so-
Secretary James and wish her and Mr. Beatty every success in their future endeavors. Please remain standing for the playing of the Air Force song and the departure of the official party. Congratulating Secretary James and Mr. Beatty in the receiving line adjacent to the UH-1 helicopter. There will be a reception immediately following on the left side of the hangar. Please remain at your seats until an usher directs you to depart. Thank you for your patience, and we wish you a pleasant day.